Hey, what's up, everyone? Welcome back to Summer of Carnage right here on the Venom Vlog. And what you're about to see is actually a review I recorded for Into the Venomverse. But because we don't have that show anymore, we're just gonna, I just wanna keep everything simple on this channel. And because it had so many Spider-Man tags and everything, I just wanted to, we're just gonna fold it back in here. So what I recorded was a Spider-Verse number one review for that just came out and a Morbius number one review. So I'm gonna cut to that here in a second. But since I'm recording a new intro, I figured I'd give out another digital code. So you're going to get a digital code for those two books in this episode. So make sure you stay tuned for that. But I have an extra copy of Venom number 19 because I bought the Mary Jane variant cover at Golden Apple Comics this past week. And so so I wanted to give this code out. So boom, there you go. First person to put that in gets Venom number 19 by Donnie Cates and Ivan Coelho, who is the artist of it. And yeah, this cover is just really beautiful. When I saw it, I was like, wow. And again, I don't really buy a lot of variants, but I was like, you know what? I'm going to give it out on the show. And, you know, that way to make up for the fact that I got to record a new intro because the last one said, hey, welcome to the Venomverse. And, you know, I just don't want to edit that in because that show doesn't exist anymore, sadly. So enjoy these two reviews that are coming up. And in the next episode, even though we did it on our live stream, I think I'm still in the next episode. We're going to do the pre-production breakdown of like the stages of pre-production because I want to do something very, very concise with that. So that's what we're going to do in the next episode. So make sure you stay tuned and subscribe so you don't miss out on that. Without further ado, let's get to my reviews. I think these came out. I know Morbius came out this week, but Spider-Verse, this I think came out either this week or last week. I can't remember. I think it was this week, but it's written by Jed MacKay, who I think wrote one of the Absolute Carnage tie-ins recently that we talked about. And I figured, you know what? It's a book that stars Miles. It's him going into the multiverse again, and it has some characters that we've seen in the movie, plus some, you know, new Spider-Verse characters. And it kind of follows the comic book lore of, you know, these characters, not so much the movie. It's not spinning out of the movie. But I still was like, eh, I'll give it a try. You know, it's one issue. It's a 6-issue miniseries. So let's see where it goes. So I picked up the first issue and there is a digital code for that. And we'll give that away when we talk about the book. Then we also have Morbius, the Living Vampire. New number one, I got the variant cover, which is really nice by Kyle Hott and Dan Brown. Really great cover. When I saw this, I was like, yeah, I got to have that. And I did want to read this. I was curious to see where they were going to take the character after what we've seen in Dan Slott's run, where he was like one of the, you know, he worked at that lab with Peter Parker as like a mysterious sixth scientist, you know, who didn't reveal himself too much later. And then I think he had his own series where he was walking around in a hoodie and he had a friend that was trying to help him come up with a cure for, you know, vampirism or something, or what his particular version of vampirism is, because he's more of a scientifically created vampire as opposed to a supernatural vampire. And that's what I've always liked about Morbius, is even in the world of vampires, he's kind of an outsider. And it's also the reason why Blade gave pause to killing him a couple times, because he's like, hey, you're still mostly human. You just have vampire tendencies and abilities that were given to you by a science experiment and not so much supernatural. And maybe there's a way in Morbius, if he gets cured one day, to cure all vampires. So Blade keeps him around, you know, in that regard too. So I was really excited to read this. I really was. And when I saw that it was coming out this week, I was like, good, I'm going to cover it on the show. But then when I got a twofer with this one, I was like, all right, cool. We'll get them both. We'll talk about them. So here's the digital code for Spider-Verse. Boom, right there on the screen. You know, first person to put that code in will get this comic. And I'd love to hear your review and your thoughts of this book down in the comment section below. There is some really neat stuff. I guess there was this little hashtag going around when Spider-Verse came out called Spider-Sona, and it was a bunch of artists from around the world just doing their versions of a spider character from a different universe. And what I liked about this is Marvel decided to grab onto that and said, hey, you know what? In each issue, we're going to feature three fans' artwork. And I'm like, wow, what a great way to shout out some of these fans around the world. And that's what they do. So they have this first one is from Thailand, and it's called Spider Requiem. And it's like a woman whose face is scarred, and she's kind of named after the Greek goddess, the Greek muse of dance. And she's a puppeteer. And so she's a strategist when it comes to battle. So the way they convey her, and it's very Tim Burton-ish, I loved it. I thought it was really cool. And she, like I said, she wears a mask because not just to conceal her identity, but because she has a scarred face and stuff. So that was cool. Then they did like the spinster here, which is a character drawn by an artist from France. And you know what? Let me give a shout out to these artists. Cotton Valent is the Thailand artist who did this verse, Spider Requiem. Then we have Antonio D'Amico, who drew the spinster here. Again, artist lives in France. Really cool. Looks great. And then we have VO3 from Poland, who did the art for this character named V, who is a robot that downloads themselves into the internet and catches people doing cyber crimes over the World Wide Web. So I was like, ah, that's kind of neat. And then the spinster here is subtle vibrations on the web she creates with her prehensile hair. The spinster can hear any conversation, no matter how far away it's taking place. Her design was inspired by noblewomen in the era of the French Revolution, as well as the original Madame Web. So that's kind of cool that they kind of did their own version of Madame Web. And then, yeah, this robot one. So that was cool that they got the fans involved to, like, create, you know, some other characters. Not characters that we're probably going to see in the story, obviously, but just giving a shout out to them and their hard work. So I like that. The book opens, though, with a really great fight between Miles and I think, I can't remember that character's name. He's got the eight ball head. I always blank on his name. Maybe, is it just eight ball? I think it is, maybe. He fights him and takes him down. And then he starts, you know, hearing a voice in his head from someone named Spider Zero. And they're going to pull him in back into the multiverse, even though in the comics, the web and the web of life and destiny was kind of destroyed during one of the big crossovers. I can't remember if it was Spider-Verse or if it was the one they did recently. I can't remember because like the two kind of blur together to me because I've only read each one time. But yeah, so the web was kind of destroyed and that connects all the different multiverses. Well, apparently May Parker, the one who was left, you know, the Spider-Girl, was left to rebuild the web. She rebuilt it and now she's gone missing. So Spider-Zero apparently is going to be the one or the chosen one that's supposed to sit at the center of the web and, you know, reach out and be like the new Madame Web in a way. So she reaches out to Miles and says, I need to bring you here. We need to talk about what, you know, with this this trouble that's happening. And I need you to help me find Mayday or May Parker or whatever. So this great spread with all the spider characters is great. And he gets pulled into the web by this green, like glowing web, gets webbed to him and pulls him back in. And then what I really like about this is the art style changes every universe that Miles goes to. So the first, you know, world he goes to is like this world where there's the spider gang and the goblin gang. And it's just a bunch of kids who dress up in spider gear and goblin gear and get into gang wars, you know, for turf, you know, in New York City. So I thought that was really cool. It's called Manhattan 2.0. And everyone, like I said, there's spider powers and there's goblin powers. And that's kind of the two rival gangs in the city. So Miles runs through there, which is pretty cool. Then Miles ends up in a world where there's monsters. So he meets the spider monster. And again, the art style changes. But my favorite one, and he does bounce around, he goes to like a Mad Max world where the X-Men are mutated and they're chasing after a spider character driving the spider buggy. I thought that was really cool. I hope we see that world again. We also get to dip into the Spider-Punk world a little bit too. So we have a Spider-Punk here talking to Miles. And he's like, finally, someone I recognize. But this one I thought was really awesome. Miles gets pulled into a manga. And look at that. He's in color. And the world is drawn very manga-y. The dialogue boxes are manga-y. It's very, very cool. When I was flipping through this, I was like, this is what made me buy the book. Honestly, when I came across this, I was like, okay, I'm buying the book just because visually I think that's really awesome that they did that. And that's where he comes across Spider Zero. And this is the young girl here. And she fills him in on the story. So, you know, that's pretty much what's going on. We just get a basic setup. Miles gets to peek into different worlds. We have Jed McKay was the writer of this, but Juan Frigeri and Carlos Lopez did some of the art in the beginning and intro. Intro and outro. Then Stacy Lee came on for a couple pages. Then we have Art Adams and Frederico Blee did the Monster Universe. James Heron and Dave Stewart did the Mad Max Universe. Decay Ruan and Carlos Lopez came back for colors, I think, for pages 11 and 12, which is the manga world. Or not manga world, right before the manga world, which is the Spider-Punk world. And then Sheldon Vella did the Spider-Verse or manga world. This one here, the black and white. So Sheldon did that one. So yeah, a lot of great artists that came together and put this book together. I like that because it reminds me very much of My Comic Soul Star, which I did, where it's like every page has a different artist on it, and it's telling like one story. That's kind of what they did here, and I really like that, and I hope that continues throughout this miniseries every time they go to a new world. And I'm pretty sure that's what's going to happen, because I think every cover has like looks like this. It has like a number of artists listed on there under Jed's name. So yeah, this was okay. It was fine. I mean, there's not a lot to it story-wise. They're building it up, so it's a good first issue, and I like some of the art choices they made. I really liked seeing Miles in black and white, or in color, but in a black and white manga world. I thought that was really, really cool, and I hope they do more stuff like that in future issues. So I would say for reviewing this was a fun read if you want to pick it up. It didn't blow me away or anything, but except for the those three pages, something about it. I mean, I love black and white. I'm a sucker for it. But seeing, you know, a character in color walking around a black and white world and it be very manga style and the lettering change and everything, like, good job on the lettering on this book. They really, not only did the art style change in each dimension, but so did the lettering styles. And I thought that was really cool. Lettering is a very specific art form, and I feel like letterers don't get a lot of credit, but this letterer team, the people that worked on this, did a really good job by changing it up each scene. I thought that was really, really great. So yeah, pick up Spider-Verse. I thought it was fun. It's you know, it's an okay book, but the art in it is what pulled me in, and I'm glad I bought it. And I'll give it at least one or two more issues to see if the story hooks me. Right now, it's like, oh, it's a setup, and we have May's missing. I am invested in that character. I do like May Parker a lot, so I'm like, yeah, let's see where this goes. So that's what I'm going to do. So I would say if that sounded interesting to you, go pick it up on digital or in print right now. And then now for the main course, for me at least, is Morbius. I really wanted to check out this book. This was going to be the only book I reviewed in this episode and talked about and discussed. But then when I saw that, I was like, all right, we'll throw that in there and we'll do a double feature here, since these are characters that now share the same universe with Venom in a way. So Morbius we have is the new intro to the character. It starts off with the Melter. He's like this like old school, like, you know, D-list villain, and he's running this, you know, lab in a warehouse, and he's got all these goons, and he's like working on something big, new chemicals. He's trying to create something, and some of his goons lead you know, Morbius to them. And so Morbius comes in, and the artwork, by the way, is fantastic. It's really, really good. I think, let me see, let me credit the writer and artist of this book. Oh crap, is there no titles? I think it's probably all the way in the back. They probably put them in there. Yeah, so Vita Ayala is the writer, and Marcelo Ferreira is the pencil artist. So I think we've talked about Marcelo before on the show. I think he filled in or did an issue of something that we talked about before. But his art on this is great. Like, look at that. Just really great. Great panel layouts, great action scenes. And so Morbius comes in and he takes all these guys down. Now, he doesn't kill any of them. He doesn't bite any of them. He doesn't infect any of them. But he does fight all of them and takes them down. I really like this shot here where he knocks Melter down, and Melter sees, he's like looking up, but it's blurry. And then he blacks out. Like, then, you know, then he blacks out before, as Morbius cuts him. So Morbius wounds a lot of these guys, but he doesn't kill any of them. And he makes a point to say that because he's trying not to give in to the beast and the monster inside of him. And he reflects on his life. There's a great scene in the middle of the book where he's like looking back at his childhood and at his life in general and kind of what led him here. He remembers his friend. So they reference that story by Keating, or I can't remember who the writer was on that one, who, you know, came up with his friend, and he was walking around in the hoodie and they were trying to come up with a cure. Well, he finally seems to have cracked the formula after all this time working. And then I guess he took some stuff from the Melter's lab and stuff. So he comes back and he's like, all right, here we go. You know, and he injects himself, and then he notices that the pain and the hunger goes away and his skin starts to turn human color, even though he still looks kind of mutated. He's not pale, like, you know, pale white anymore. And he feels like, all right, this is going to happen. It's working. I'm actually going to slowly revert back to my human form. And so it looks like he may have cured himself, but of course things go wrong. And the injection that he, or the serum he injected himself with, doesn't work fully. And so it ends up turning him even into something maybe way worse. And while that's happening, the Melter gets a visit from a mysterious hunter who is looking for Michael Morbius. And so she makes herself present and she says, yeah, normally I would take someone like you down, Melter, but we have a common enemy and I really care more about taking down Michael Morbius and vampires in general. So at first I thought it was maybe going to be Blade, and then Blade was just going to kill Melter and then everyone else in the room and then just go after Morbius. And maybe he's just like, you know, this guy, I gave him a chance to cure himself and he didn't. I thought that would have been cool. But whoever this character is, I thought maybe it was Elsa Bloodstone at first, but it doesn't look like her at all. So I actually don't know who this character is. So if one of you guys do, let me know, because she seems kind of familiar, but I'm drawing a blank right now. But she's coming in as the hunter to hunt down Michael Morbius. And then, of course, like I said, he turns into something way worse. His eyes go all black. His teeth, you know, go from human back to vampire. And he becomes like full on beast mode by the end. So yeah, it's another setup book. It's like Spider-Verse. I would say not much story wise happened in this one. It was very much a first issue in the sense that where you're like, all right, the point is here, like he's looking for a cure, and then he tries it and it goes wrong. So the setup and the point of the book is made very clear, which, you know, is good. It's writing 101, obviously. So we know where the journey is. Like, his journey here is to find that cure, but he messed up on his first go around, and so we're gonna have to deal with the ramifications of that. And then also we have a bounty hunter or a, vampire hunter after him who's willing to team up with D-list villains like Melter to kind of, who wants revenge for, his lab and everything and his men getting beat up and everything. And I love it because right after his men get beat up, they all wake up and Melter's like, "Oh man," he's like, "What happened?" He's like, "Anyone dead?" And they're like, "No, no one's dead." And then one guy's in the background, he goes, "I quit." Like he's just like, "I'm done." And he's like, I didn't sign up to fight vampires. Like, what the hell was that thing?" And that's what I really liked was the horror movie aspect at the beginning where the men are being chased by Morbius throughout the warehouse and they're like hiding behind things and he jumps down from above and it's like I was like, "Wow, it's done really well." And it shows how scary it must be. That it's like, all right, you're thinking Iron Man's gonna show up or Spider-Man or someone, and to see a vampire show up, it freaks these guys out. And so I was like, all right, that's cool. Like that's the side of the Marvel universe I've always liked, is like the supernatural spooky side with Ghost Rider and Doctor Strange and Blade and the Midnight Suns and all that, and Morbius and Darkhold and all those books from the early 90s. And of course we're gonna have more Ghost Rider stuff coming up. Those of you who are out there fans of that stuff and fans of me going through my collection, we'll have more of those on Highway to Hell coming up very soon. I'll probably do more next week and I'll take this week off to catch up on these things. And then we'll probably bring back Transformers and stuff in early December. So we got more issues of that to review as well. So, but yeah, as far as this goes, this Morbius book was a good start. I like the artwork a lot. And the storylines, like I said, it hooked me in the sense that, okay, I get the basic premise, I get the idea, let's see where they go with it. And so for that reason alone, I'm going to keep up with it. I'm probably going to give it at least, it says it's an ongoing series, but I'm sure that's going to depend on sales and stuff. So I'm willing to give it at least 6 issues. So you guys will probably see me talk more about these on the show. I might wait till, 2, 3, and 4, whenever the first arc ends. I might wait till then and we'll do a full discussion from what happens here on out. I probably won't review each issue. Unless we're slow on videos that week, then maybe I'll be pulled into doing a review and stuff. But for the most part, I just wanted to at least get this review out there and talk about it so you guys knew that there was a new Morbius book on the stand if you didn't already know. And I would say if you're interested, if you're slightly interested, I'd say pick it up. It's worth at least the purchase for the first issue, and then you can make up your own mind if you want to go forward from there. But yeah, so those are the two books I want to talk about. We had the digital codes given out when I was talking about those issues. So if you got the digital codes, let me know what your review is in the comments down below. And as always, if you have any comments, we'll continue our conversation down there. We'll have more Into the Venomverse stuff coming up. I'll try to look for more Morbius movie news. I'm sure we'll get a trailer after the holidays at some point early next year for the movie, if not sooner, at least a teaser trailer or something. I'm sure we're going to have something coming up. So I'll do a reaction video to that on this show. And then anything Spider-Verse movie related, I'll obviously talk about. I think they said, I wouldn't say it was a confirmation, but I think Chris Miller, someone said, "Hey, are you going to put like the Japanese Spider-Man in it? If not, I'd like to design him." And Chris Miller said, "Oh, we already got a design for him." And it's like, okay, that's great. But that doesn't mean he's in the movie. I mean, there's probably a couple spider characters they designed for the first movie and couldn't squeeze into the story. So it doesn't mean that, the Japanese Spider-Man is going to be in the next one, but at least they have a design for him out there. So that is one little bit of movie news, but I didn't feel like that was worth making a whole video on, because again, I wouldn't say that was strict confirmation, because the movie's still like 2 years from coming out, so a lot can change between now and then. But it was cool to at least see Chris Miller acknowledge that and acknowledge that fan and at least give us a hint that at least one spider character has been designed, and hopefully they do show up in the movie. So yeah, let me know your thoughts on all that down below. We'll continue our conversation there, and let me know your reviews of these, if you got the digital codes, and if you read them yourself. I'd love to hear your thoughts as well. Thanks so much for watching the show. As always, like, share, subscribe, all that fun stuff, and I'll see you in the future. Peace.